The next session is the opposite. Having a fantastic business, being a leader in many traditional areas, but still being faced with the challenges of transforming and digitizing and capturing the opportunities of a digitized business environment. And she's also one of my favorite leaders. She runs almost 80 billion crown Axel Jonsson-gruppen, but she comes from a long career as a board professional, as an executive in telecom, in media, in all kinds of different industries. And I'm very, very happy to introduce Mia Brunell Livfors. Welcome up on stage. We can come here. Here. Very welcome.
Hey.
I steal a hug.
Thank you.
Hey. So, and since you are a brave leader and also likes technology, I'm going to try something I've never tried. This is something we can potentially sit on.
Okay.
And it's supposed to fly. I'm not sure. But are you comfortable? Good?
I'm comfortable.
So hopefully it will fly. I don't know. Yeah, it flies. Whoa.
Oh.
So, yeah? And anyway, I think this is kind of what the insurance covers, this height. I want to ask you, your CEO, Axel Jonsson,
and yes.
We might have people from other planets or people from far away that doesn't know what you're doing. So could you just, what is Axel Jonsson in a nutshell?
Yes, Axel Jonsson is a leading retail group, mainly in the Nordic regions, which has a little bit more than 70 billion Swedish kronor in turnover. And it's a family-owned business, and with well-known brands like Willys, Hemköp, Åhléns, Kicks, for those of you that are Swedish here, and it's with an ambition to be leading in the segments where we are.
And I want to go into that and how that transition is going. But first, you know, take us back to, you've had a long career with Kinnevik and you sort of early days of TV1000 and a lot of transformational industries before. Yeah. So could you take us back? Where did you start your career and sort of how?
Yeah, when I graduated from university, I started in the finance industry, but this was the late 80s. So soon came the financial crisis in the early 90s. It seems so long ago to talk about it. But anyway, so I had to find a new job, and I ended up at TV1000. I thought it sounded exciting with pay TV, which was new at the time.
Yeah, but then it was like 15 employees or something like that.
Exactly, something like that. And no one thought we would be profitable. We made huge losses, and everybody said, who would want to pay for television? But people ended up doing. So, and after that, I stayed in Kinnevik for more than 20 years.
But you worked a lot with Jan Stenbeck as well.
Well, I wasn't one of the closest people to him, but he was, his era was around the company, and yes. So, I mean, I think we started several hundred companies during those 20 years. So,
and what were some of the, I mean, Kinnevik is, especially back then, were often accused of being a very tough environment, a very sort of boys environment a little bit. Was that true, or what were the, how was it to work there?
I never experienced it like that. I think it was, if you say tough, I think it was straightforward and very direct and not very political. So I thought it was good. It was probably good to get things done.
Yeah. And now you have been a little over a year in Axel Jonsson.
Yes.
And what are some of the things, when you look at digitization, how do you look upon that? I mean, retail is going to change dramatically.
Yes.
Groceries is going to be changed differently. Fashion is going to be shopped differently. And all these different industries. How do you sort of, you know, wake up in the morning and have an idea what you're going to do with all that? I get sort of...
That's what's so exciting. I think that, as you say, retail is seeing a lot of change. And I think that the changes that we'll see in the coming 10 years will be more than what we've seen in the last 100 years. And that's what makes it so fun, or one of the things that makes it so fun. And I think that we're looking for growth with profitability, but also with sustainability, and to really build something future for the customer. So I think that's...
But where do you start? Where do you start the journey? What are sort of the buttons you start pushing?
I think that the most important button, which I've experienced during this year, is awareness in the company. When you have a company that is very successful, it's also very difficult to see, maybe at the same time that you're extremely good at doing what you do today and doing it very well, to see the necessity and urgency of change.
But how do you create awareness or even buy-in from skeptics or, you know, the traditional heroes?
Sort of. Facts, education, and patience. So I think we've had a lot.
Facts, education, and patience. Cool.
I think we've had, and some impatience as well. Yeah. I think we've had a lot of sessions with bringing in external people and internal people, and making sure that people are sort of feel comfortable in our work. Because even if you're here today and you know that you want to be there, somewhere else in 5 years' time. But how do you do that? So I think that making people comfortable with just the vocabulary and the atmosphere and what has to be done, and seeing that, yes, it can be done, and we'll find the competence to do it.
And how much of it is driven sort of from the top, from the owner group, and how much of it happens in an Åhléns or in a Hemköp or some, you know, some of the other brands you're having?
Yeah, it's a very decentralized group, which I think it has to be done. I mean, you have to really work close to the customer, close to the ground, because that's where it has to happen. But I think that what we try to do is to inspire and guide and maybe irritate.
Inspire, guide, and irritate. I'm getting so many key takeaways here. But if you look at obstacles then to digital transformation, yeah, what are some of the obstacles that you run into?
Well, I think I think the main one is what I said, creating the awareness when you're extremely good at doing what you do today and you have a successful business, mm-hmm, in making that bridge, really. But also to find the competence, because to some extent you need additional competence that you haven't had before. So I think that finding that, I think there's a huge competition in Stockholm for good competence, particularly in the digital.
And as a leader, you recruited a lot of people. What do you look for when you recruit people?
I look for, well, right now, if I look at future leaders, I look at agility. I think it's important, gut and guts, but also I think diversity is important to really make. Get different opinions and not just have a homogeneous group of people but to really create a dialogue and friction. I think friction is important to get something
new. I heard that from Ricardo as well. He's Italian, yeah, and they can argue about anything, but it's just that he saw that the conflict was such an important strategic tool in groups.
It is. I mean, you need friction to start a fire, so it's the same with people.
And you're also one of the most experienced board professionals in this country as well. And you sit on a lot of boards and have been sitting on a lot of boards.
Yeah.
Are they changing attitude towards digital? And what's happening in sort of board world?
A lot, I think, over the past 10 years. Mm. A lot, yeah. But I also think it's important that you don't have a digital, what we try to do at Axel Johnson, you don't have a separate digital strategy or a separate sustainability strategy. I think it has to be integrated. It has to be part of what you do and not like a checklist on the side. So that's something that we work very hard with, to have an integrated business plan and not separate strategies.
If you look at, is there something you're losing sleep over? It's like, okay, retail, will there be stores in the future? How will they be? And what do we need to do to make these stores worthy of everybody that is there today? I mean, there's so much excitement going on the future in retail. And personally, I think it's if retail stores just do what they do right now, it won't be good for them.
No.
But they could become something completely different. And then maybe, you know, they'll take the cheese from the e-commerce players or others as well.
I think that's good. I wish I knew what we were looking for and what it would look like in 5 years' time. That would make my life quite simple today, or easy, but it's not. And I think that's both what is exciting, but also what you lose sleep over, is that you have to take it step by step and try new things and you know, prioritize. But because it's sometimes two steps forward and one step backward, and you have to try.
How do you handle them, as you know, personally, as a leader? How do you handle when things don't go well?
Well, you get angry, but there is no point in really dwelling too much about it. It obviously was mistakes are never planned, but they have to happen. Otherwise, if you don't make mistakes, you make too little. So I think that you just have to move on and say, okay, so that didn't work out, so what do we do then? And just look forward all the time. I
work in a group where we have 12 companies and they're all small, and I feel that I'm doing a lot of different things.
Yeah.
Where do you get your energy? Where do you fuel your passion when you have all these different things? And I mean,
I do get a lot of energy from the people I work with. Mm-hmm. I think that's very important. The best advice I can give, because that's when you work as a team and you feel that you have the same target and the same engagement. I think that's one of the things. But then you know, also family, friends, exercise, books, whatever. Yeah, I think you have to do different kind of things. I don't rest much. I think that change is more inspiration.
And if you would leave some sort of really concrete things in the room, many people are leaders of large transforming companies themselves were advisors to them and so forth. What are some of those, what would some of those advice be for driving transformation?
Well, I think that you have to accept that the people that will make the change have to be on board. And then you need to listen to them and you need to make them engaged and really, because it's not going to happen if they are not convinced to do it the right way as well. To really get people on board, even though that's sometimes a long process.
And sometimes that means also changing people,
yes,
I would imagine.
Absolutely.
And finishing off, what's most exciting right now? What do you think is sort of, what, especially in the context of digital and innovation, and what are some of the things that you sort of...
Being here, meeting you and all of you. I think that I hope that we'll have inspirational meetings and maybe potential partnerships. I think that innovation is exciting, but difficult, and that's something that we have a target to, which is called 10-50, that in 10 years' time, 50% of what we do has to be new things. It can be completely new things, new businesses, or just new revenue streams or new products, but that's finding the right innovative climate and new partnerships, potentially.
But you're also a very different type of investor or venture capitalist.
Yes.
You don't buy to sell and make money, typically.
No.
You buy to buy more and then own it and make the companies part of the families. I like that company-building tradition of
yeah.
the group.
Yeah, exactly. We're looking to find partnerships in things that can be of strategic importance for us or ideas that we strongly believe in. Mm. But we work very closely with entrepreneurs, so we're not there to necessarily take over control or to build things that we think, that we believe in.
One thing I also wanted to ask you is about the data. If I look at the group, you have everything we shop, you have all of this data and all the customer clubs and everything else. Do you think that will be a future business area as well? And
how? I think so. Everybody talks about it.
And yeah.
We have more than 9 million transactions every week or something like that, so it's a lot of data. But legislation also makes it a bit difficult to use it as you wish. But no, I think that will be important. But I think that very few do it great today. So I think that's an area that everybody talks about, but it still has to be developed.
So I'm certainly going to be trying to stay close and hear what happens. I think it's a yeah. fascinating group. And if you haven't read the history, it's also a very important part of Swedish business history, I think.
Mm-hmm. It's almost 150 years old.
So thank you very much for coming here sharing, and now
thank
we'll
you.
Descend if this works. No, otherwise we'll just stay here. I'll yeah. have a great time. And it works. And our dear producer Mats, he comes up with these things and they happen in the morning when I come here and I can never try them. So we actually tried this live here, which
and
I
it's kind of fun. It
gives credit to you. Technology
thank
and bravery.
Thank you. It was a challenge. I'm a
thank
bit afraid
very,
of
very
heights.
Thank you very, very much. You got that. Thank you.
Thank you.
So and with that, I hope and believe that you have your head spinning with lots of new thoughts. You have your Tinderish-like app going warm, and you want some coffee, tea, and some other things. So with that, we go for a break for half an hour, and we'll see you back here at Main Stage. Thank you very much.